Hi, welcome once again to Shifting Focus, a talk show with Sanjay Gupta. I hope all of you are safe, sound and healthy. I'm Sanjay Gupta, work with DS Group and head its packaging development and procurement function. As you know, here in this show, we invite most provoking business leaders, innovators and game changers who speak their mind about social, political, constitutional, psychological, geographical, global, and consumer issues arise due to this pandemic and way forward. Today, it's really an honor for us as we have invited one of the most experienced and seasoned professional, Mr. Rakesh Mohan, ex-chairman of Unilever, Malaysia, Singapore, Myanmar, Cambodia, and Laos. I will very quickly go through his rich profile. Mr. Rakesh Mohan is a mechanical engineer and alumni of Narasimha Munji Institute of Management, Mumbai, and prestigious Wharton Business School, USA. He started his career way back in 1985 with Electrolux or Eureka Forbes by door-to-door selling of vacuum cleaners. Then he worked with Mattel Toys and joined Unilever in 1990 as an area sales manager. Within a span of 12 years, he was elevated to a position of MD with Unilever Nepal. He also served Unilever Bangladesh in the capacity of managing director. And finally, he was chairman of a cluster of five diverse countries like Malaysia, Singapore, Cambodia, Laos, and Myanmar. What a diversified portfolio and experience. Hats off to you, sir. I think it would be really, really very interesting to have your enriching experience for the industry. And I welcome once again Mr. Rakesh Mohan on this show. All of us are very, very delighted to have your views.
Thank you for inviting me, Sanjay. Very nice of you.
Thank you so much. So I will start the conversation. So, sir, my first question is, sir, if you see, marketing has evolved over a period of time into various eras, such as production-centric, then product, then to sales, marketing, and then holistic marketing. Do you think that the current unexpected, never thought of pandemic, wherein all business models are forced to change, will some new era of marketing evolve? If it is evolved, is the whole supply chain ready for this new marketing era? Because all of us are changing like anything, our behavior, our socializing, our consumption, our spending, everything is changing. So what do you feel about it?
So firstly, there is no doubt there is going to be a big change in the way people will work now, the people will shop now, and the way people will live. Okay. So I think the big change which has happened is the way people will work. It will be no longer necessary for people to go all the way through the traffic, sitting in a car or a vehicle for long hours, stuck in traffic. The whole concept of work from home has taken over. This always used to exist, but there was a lot of resistance. So number one, we used to get resistance from the employees themselves, okay, because they didn't have space at home, they didn't have the privacy at home, or they didn't have internet at home, or they didn't have the equipment at home. And of course, there was the employer also who was very reluctant to let people work from home because they were also uncertain about the productivity drop, whether people will scoot off, whether they'll really work. Now, very interestingly, all that hurdles have been overcome very quickly. Okay, so that mindset which people used to have that you can't work from home because what will your neighbors think that you don't have a job? I think all that has changed. Okay, so I think that's one big change which has come, which is going to affect people's life. Okay, and then the way they live. They were. So there's not going to be much of need for people to travel to work. They'll not go for meetings. They will not have to, you know, fly all over the country to meet up. They will use video. So this will change the thing which will sell and which will not sell. Obviously, transportation will come down. Okay, flights will come down. Hotels will come down. But on balance will go up will be internet. So everybody will not need high-speed internet at home. Okay, there will be opportunities more for digital advertising. So there is surely going to be a shift, okay, due to this change in the behavior. The other thing is, what is going to change is the way people will buy. Okay, now people will no longer want to go to buy, okay, in shops which are crowded, stand in those markets, in the fresh vegetable markets, because the fear is there. Of course, this might not be a very permanent change, but surely the time more passes and people spend more time buying online, they will get used to buying online. Also, then they will find reliable retailers who deliver them right quality of fresh food, packaged food at fair prices. And this could be a change which could happen in the channel shift. Okay, so marketeers would need to change because people no longer go and buy from the nearby Kirana. They'll either send a message somewhere or they'll buy it through an app. So the way people will shop is surely going to change. That will require marketeers to relook at the way that they will market their product and the channel through which they will sell. Also, now there's going to be a new set of, should I say, opportunities which will come. Okay, now people are not going to meet in plain clubs and gatherings so much. Okay, so they will require apps and other technology which will help them to still engage. Okay, like to have meetings like we are using a Zoom. Okay, so you might find social meeting continuing on Zoom and people get used to it. Also, you know, there are all sorts of apps and people can play sitting around in different places. So it will create new markets. Okay, so marketeers have to adapt to the new ways of working. Surely going to change the way people will market products and marketeers need to change. So let us look what are the type of changes which need to happen. So first thing is digital marketing. Okay, so the traditional marketing or point of purchase, communication, whether it is on television, I think all that is going to shift dramatically towards more digital. Because after all, people are spending more time on their apps, on their phones, on their laptops. So digital marketing share of spend, okay, from marketeers, advertising budgets will surely increase. Also, they will need to build more capabilities in digital marketing.
Yes.
The other thing which is going to happen, if you're going to say that people are going to buy in omni-channels and use their e-commerce sites to buy, then the channels are going to shift. So companies and market need to now think, how do we increase our market share in these channels? How do the product delivered through these channels safely? So that will require a new mindset change. It opens up a lot of opportunities. And companies which are nimble-footed, who can adapt quickly, will surely increase their share as these new channels will develop. People will become more conscious of buying from companies, okay, which follow sustainable practices, which are known that during difficult times were helping people, were helping community, were taking care of their employees. So people would be more favorably inclined, making it more important, okay, for marketeers to bring up the social angle of their companies, to bring up the sustainability initiatives of their company. Likely, there will be downgrading because there has been a lot of job losses. There has been a lot of shrinking of work, okay, salary cuts. So they might be downsizing, and hence companies and marketeers need to be very conscious of the portfolio. So they must make sure that they offer price points, affordable price points. So if people need to downtrade in the interim, that, you know, these sort of price points are available so you don't lose your customers. And finally, there is going to be this thing about minimal human engagement. People now don't want to necessarily go and touch someone or to talk to someone or go to a shop when they need a service. They want a no-touch, technologically delivered a service. So all these are new challenges and opportunities which marketeers must embrace, okay, and find quick solutions. And the guys who do it better will be surely the one which will do better. So I think this is a change which has happened, okay. Most of it will get embedded in behavior. Some of it might go back to the old ways. People might still go back to cinema halls after some time, go and eat out after some time. Some of those things will come back. But a lot of change will stay for good. And it's an opportunity because I think it's a very quick leap. Okay, which normally a normal evolution of these channels would have taken many years. But now we see it will happen very quickly. So I'm quite positive about the changes as long as companies and marketers adapt quickly.
I think one very interesting point which you have raised is the price point. But as a consumer, what we are observing that most of the companies have either increased their prices or reduced their schemes to the retailers. So ultimately, consumer is getting the same product at a increased prices, but they were buying more prior to pandemic. So I think it's a very, very important insight which you have raised, because people's salaries are down, their earnings are not much. So at least price point should be softened, should be less. But I think companies are not thinking in this direction as of now. But as a consumer, I can say, not as a company spokesperson.
So look, packaged goods have their prices printed on the top. So it is normally as people downtrade, okay, whether they will shift their brand or whether they buy the same brand and buy less quantity. So I'm talking more from the perspective, people given the choice would still like to stay in the same brand which they're used to. They're familiar with the brand, they're familiar with the quality, they just don't want to change it. So they prefer to downtrade to a smaller pack size, okay, and consume less when times are difficult. So we must make sure we have smaller packs, okay, packs which are available at lower prices so people can afford them. And as far as you're saying, as the total price inflation, we have to really wait and watch how that unfolds. So there is some news that inflation is creeping up. So we have to wait and watch. But by and large, I think companies have to make sure the price point is important. So we must make sure you make small sachets, you make small packs, so that people get an opportunity not to have to change their brand. They can continue to enjoy whatever they were enjoying before.
But if companies will come up with a small packaging, small sachets, then the contact point will increase. At one hand, I would like to buy a bigger pack so that I need not to go to the market again and again. So I think there are different views on this.
So it's like this, that different consumers, okay, will have different needs. Okay. So a guy who is a daily wage earner, okay, who pulls a rickshaw, okay, who does a daily wage, okay, he can't afford a big pack. So we can't ignore them because that is a big chunk in the belly of the market. Okay. Yes. So they earn every day, they need to buy their provisions every day. So in that they will buy a small sachet of shampoo, or maybe they will buy a small sachet of toothpaste. So you can't ignore that segment. So there are the other segment which is not affected, and they might continue to buy bigger packs and even upgrade and upgrade. But they, you cannot ignore that the mass of the Indian consumers are very, very price conscious. And the cash outflow at a point of time for a daily wage earner is very important.
So it means a shift to the bigger packaging, maybe a short term.
No, so you know, different needs will be there. So the daily wage earners and people really have low incomes, okay, who buy every day, small quantities, regularly, frequently, because they don't get the money, you know, at the beginning of the month. They are the ones who would downtrade or buy small packs. Whereas the ones who have regular incomes, who are used to buying it, they buy it and they look for an economy pack, will continue to buy bigger packs.
So, I think there are two insights from you. One is the price point, which should be affordable. Second is technology upgradation for every industry.
Yes, particularly in the area of digital communication, okay, e-commerce. That is a big area, delivering without contact. That is an area of technology where everybody will have to very quickly now really step up. Yes. So that's a big change, and it has happened discontinuously.
But do you feel that small companies would be able to do these changes very quickly?
Well, we must not underestimate small companies, okay? Because they are more nimble-footed, they are more creative, they are more entrepreneurial. After, a lot of the e-commerce people are all young startups. So don't underestimate the capability of small companies. Oh, so small companies have strength, particularly nimble-footedness, entrepreneurial. I think they will cope. And Indians are entrepreneurial by nature. So I feel positive that you would see a lot of, you know, if you stop the Chinese apps, the Indian apps will start working much better, faster. Most people, they will see the opportunity. I think Indians by and large are entrepreneurs. So they will grasp this opportunity.
Oh, very nice. Very nice. I think very good optimistic view from you. So I will move to my second question. Sir, it is very interesting that you had been leading Bangladesh prior to India. So first of all, you were leading Unilever India, then Bangladesh, then Nepal, and then group of five countries like Malaysia, Singapore, Myanmar, Cambodia, and Laos. All are having a diverse set of socio-economical, political, geographical, and psychological diversity. If you see Singapore, per capita income is very high, modern outlook. Then Myanmar, low penetration, small shops, low income. How do you compare these extreme diverse conditions and specifically in this adverse environment for sustaining businesses? So I think these are very, very complex, and your experience might give some light to the today's people that how they should operate.
Okay. So firstly, how these global companies operate is really to look for areas where there is synergy. Okay. And where is it important actually to think local? So what we say is think global, act local. Right? So it is not important that the whole world will be homogeneous. Okay. But there are something which brings synergy into a company across the globe. Okay. So in areas like technology development, new products, new formulations, okay, and IT processes, and whether it is finance processes, whether it is HR. So there's a lot of synergy to do all that at one point rather than each country doing everything. Okay. So where is it that where you think global is in developing new molecules, new formulations, new technologies, new manufacturing things? Also, there is a lot of synergy globally when you would put in factories rather than put factories everywhere. Normally, you put factories in locations which make sense, you know, geographically. Not necessarily every country needs to have its own factory because that doesn't prove economical. So there's synergy in supply chain. There's synergy in putting up factories. Okay. And then there is, of course, very important is that you must understand the local culture and make sure your go-to-market strategies align to what the local culture is. So whether it's the pack size, pack pricing, the branding, you know, the local language, and then the advertising, the communication, all that needs to be localized. So you can't have a global, you know, advertising which fits all. Okay. So similarly, you can have a formulation which works on different type of hair, a shampoo formulation. Okay. In Southeast Asia, works in some countries, one formulation. In another, they have a different type of hair. Okay. You have a different formulation for that hair type. In some countries, there is more oil in the hair. Okay. You need a different formulation where the habit is to use more oil. Okay. But all the formulations can be centrally developed. Okay. And then each country can choose what its need is and then select it and then use those formulations. So that is where we say we think global, but we act local. So the local company would do its own advertising creatives, okay, based on the local culture, based on the local festivals, based on the local sentiment, okay, and look for local opportunities for activation. All that is done in the country. So there are some things where we see synergy when you do it globally or at the regional level, and we see some opportunities to give people space on the ground to do what they feel like. So I was just explaining, you know, on how we think global and act local. So that is how we actually can synergize and yet give space to each country to do what is right for their country. Now, coming to your question about what are these countries doing in this current situation?
Yeah.
I think the first responsibility of any good company is to make sure that the employees and community, okay, they do their bit to make sure that they are safe. I think safety of the employees and the community, the factory workers, okay, that we do whatever required to ensure that they don't become sick. So I think that becomes the first most primary responsibility. Then how is it that we can help community? So we've got brands like Lifebuoy to make sure that, and Lifebuoy is antibacterial soap, and we've got these Lifebuoy hand wash. We've got the Lifebuoy anti, you know, the sanitizer, the alcohol-based sanitizers, to make sure we can really step up production of these and make them affordable price available, okay, so that everybody can have access to these, some basic stuff which will help them to stay healthy. So I think in terms of the community and employees, that becomes the first priority. When you look at the financials, what do we need to do as a company, you know, to make sure that our survival and our growth continues, is to first make sure, look, there is going to be a drop in volume. There is no doubt about it. Okay. So we've lost some time. There is going to be some down trading. You know, some people will not be able to afford to buy some of the things they would like to buy. So the first thing is to make sure you protect cash. Okay. In these sort of situations, okay, you see how do you conserve cash? Okay. How do you optimize your spends on advertising? How do you make sure you bring down your inventory? Making sure cash flows are healthy, I think, becomes the first top priority. So like I was saying, is that the first priority is taking care of employees, community, whatever we can do to help them to be safe and healthy. Next thing is to make sure in terms of cash, okay, that the cash flows of the company are maintained healthily. So bring down inventories, okay, make sure you actually make generate cash, okay. And I think the third most important thing is to make sure the supply chain keeps turning. Okay. So because the factories have problems.
It's what you did in Nepal.
Yeah. Correct. Okay. Yeah. You got to make sure you keep your factories running because workers, okay, have to be kept healthy. They have to be bought back if they have gone off. Next thing is, you know, your vendors cannot meet delivery commitments. Okay. So you have to make sure each and every vendor is really up to speed to deliver. You might need to develop new vendors if you're not going to take stock from China. So other such sort of things, the supply chain, I think, would be an important priority to address. So it's quite simple. Take care of your people and community. Do what best you can. Preserve cash. Keep your supply chain in journey.
Oh, nice. So my third question is slightly psychological in nature. The pandemic has caused a lot of anxiety amongst the people, with the overall economy and businesses being impacted all over the globe. How do you suggest one should tackle it? Do you think that mind training and real motivation will now serve as important subjects and development traits? Because all of us are keep on hearing the news, all pessimistic news world around. So how to tackle it? How can the psychological level of an employee or morale of an employee can be increased?
So first thing is, we have to keep reinforcing to ourselves and others that this will pass. This will pass.
Yes.
Okay. So mankind has many such things. Okay, calamities come and they go, and you know, human beings will always, should I say, prevail. So we must have that confidence and we must have that faith. That is the first most important thing. We must have it ourselves. And then we must surely share it and spread it to others. Okay, so how to deal with the situation? Let's look at it from two angles. Okay, one thing as an individual, as a human being. Okay, and I think everybody has got affected. Okay, so salaries have been cut. We all know that. People have lost jobs. We know that. Okay, you know, people who are retired, interest rates have gone down. Okay, yeah. So incomes are gone. People who had the saving invested into stock have seen the stocks crash. Okay, thank God they're starting to recover. Okay. People who had even put into debt, okay, has seen what happened in Templeton. So I think everybody is feeling the pain, okay. Those who have bought flats, okay, and paying installments, the buildings don't get completed. So I think everybody is facing pain. So as individuals, okay, how do we deal with it? Okay, so I think that's one aspect one can think about. And next thing is, how do companies deal with it?
Okay. I think you have so coming first, points.
Yeah. So if I were to look at it, what is it that an individual should do? First thing, I think everybody really needs to focus on making sure they take care of themselves and their health. I think you can't afford to fall sick, because it is, you know, if you're unlucky, it can be very, very difficult. So everybody really needs to work on their health to build their natural immunity. Make sure you take care of all the PPE that you wear, a mask. Just try not to fall sick. I think that's the most, number one, important thing. Number two is, now you are going to feel the stress, okay, of job cuts, salary cuts and all that. I think it's important to also now look at your mental health. Okay, you really need to make sure, okay, that you manage to maintain the positive fighting spirit. That I think is the most important thing. And if you don't have a job now, rather than get depressed about it, okay, is use the time to upskill yourself. Okay, if you're on the bench, use it an opportunity to do something different, learn some new skill. I think everybody has got to find their own way to keep fighting against this whole setback and wait for it to pass. So everybody must have the faith that it will pass. As far as companies are concerned, this is the time where they will have to think that they need to be very nimble footed. So whether it is demand forecasting, because it is going to change very fast. You know, the products might stop selling, other products might start, you know, selling more. You cannot have the old traditional, you know, we'll produce and we'll see how it sells work. They need to be nimble footed. They'll have to find ways to optimize cost. Consumer needs and behavior are changing. We were discussing that in the beginning. Okay, so the marketers will have to adapt to that. And companies will surely have to be much more socially responsible, because people are going to get sensitive, okay, to these sort of things when they buy products. So fortunately for Unilever, we've got a portfolio of brands, okay, which takes and covers many of these price points, benefits, portfolios. We buy our own culture, are very conscious of taking care of the welfare of the community, our employees. I think all companies really need to start thinking about these things. And I'm sure it will pass. We must have the faith it will pass.
I think very, very important insights from you on keeping the mental health intact and upskilling the anybody's skills further. And sir, one my last question. What is about the climate change? Next very big question is climate change.
So you're talking about the environment, the climate change, the environment. That's what you would mean, not the economical situation. So yeah, so look, I think right now, if you were to ask me, climate change might suddenly take a backseat, because I think people have got other bigger things to grapple. And over the next 18 months, okay, you might find that everybody's focus will be first to get the vaccine out, to get human beings back into their normal lives, okay. And it might be that this climate change things will take a little backseat. But given that, it will surely come back again. But I think already a lot of, should we say, steps have been taken. Okay, so whether it is to shift to renewable energy, move out of all these polluting vehicles, bring in electric vehicles, electric cars, okay. I think that trend has already started. So we can hope that, the climate change roadmap which has been drawn up, okay, despite some countries which are very powerful, not any longer supporting that. But we must again always have faith that, yes, it is something which is needed, people understand it, and that journey will continue.
Okay, right. And sir, I think you have already shown a lot of optimism in your voice, which is very, very critical to industry. But I still ask, are you really optimistic?
So look, there is going to be an impact, like I said, okay. So there is no denying that there can be no impact. But if you were to ask me, look, is that impact going to destroy the economy? That will now people suddenly not have work after a year? No, it's not going to be like that. Okay. Yeah, there is going to be pain. There is going to be pain. This year is the worst pain. Okay. But we have seen that it will recover, because it is not that human beings are going to stop consuming things, or they will get it over. The vaccine will come out one day, whether it's 18 months or whether it is 6 months. Your guess is as good as mine. Okay. But it has to pass. But there is pain, okay, and I was saying that the pain is for individuals. We lose jobs, salaries go, investments go. We will feel the pain, but it has happened. If you will see, it has happened in the past also. It is not the first time that man did such a thing. It passed, okay. So we must have faith that this will also pass. We must have faith that it will pass, okay. We must take a position in life that, yeah, this is not permanent. A vaccine will come one day, it will come. But yes, there is economic loss, activity. Almost 2-3 months of lockdown, 2-3 months of, economic activity completely stopped. Okay, some industries are going to take a very bad hit, we know that. But they have to adapt. Okay, so if the airline industry, the travel tourism industry is going to take a hit, then they need to relook and reinvent their business model. So we can't say, oh, we're hit. No, you've got to do something about, your business model, what works. So there might be integration, amalgamations, reduction in capacities. Will find its way. But yes, some industries will completely have to reinvent themselves. You can't deny that it's not going to be painful, and there's only optimism ahead. It is going to be painful, but at the end of the thing, it will come out. Should we see a new, renovated, industry in many cases?
Because there might be a big change in all the business landscapes.
Of course, so supply chain, like we are saying, sourcing from China might become no longer, but it opens up opportunities. Yes. If you're not going to source from China, then it opens up opportunities for other countries who are quick, to grab market share, okay, as the, industry will pull out sourcing from China. It has to go somewhere. It opens up a whole lot of opportunities for all countries. It's just who can grab the opportunities. So let us look at it now. Let us look at it positively.
Be competitive then, no?
So then we need to make ourselves competitive. We can't sit back and say, oh, we are not competitive. So why are we not competitive? We have so much labor, the way industry is constructed in this country, the ease of doing business, I think is much talked about. Now is the best time to do that. If you go and see doing business in countries like Vietnam, whether it is, to go and do it in Malaysia, because they will all compete for the same industry. So you'll have Vietnam, you'll have, all the Southeast Asian countries competing from whatever will be lost to China will be the gain of Southeast Asia and Asia. Yeah. Now, the guys who have the best, capability to attract investment, okay, provide the infrastructure and provide a disciplined ease of doing business, will get market share from China. If you will see in garments, okay, so at one time China was the biggest supplier, but today almost 8 to 10% of the market share has been taken over by Bangladesh and other countries like, Cambodia are getting into it. So there is opportunity to take market share from China. Now the question is that which countries are able to, but from whatever I have seen, Southeast Asian countries are better poised, better positioned. Yeah. India still is not. ease of doing business is very difficult.
We have
so getting been, land over difficult. Getting the licenses are difficult over here. So the labor laws are difficult over here. So, but I think it's the government
reforms are required in the labor, land, and other areas.
Exactly. Yeah. Hmm. And we really must welcome entrepreneurs and industry.
Yes.
Which we don't really. But whereas if you go to a country like Malaysia, okay, they welcome them. So they make it easy for them.
Are
so then
living in India?
Well, whatever little I hear and see, she's not really made too much progress. Otherwise, we would have seen a change on the ground also, isn't it? The industries would have come up. You'd be hearing about investments coming in. We don't hear big numbers, okay? So I guess it is still to change a lot. So to do much better.
Thank you so much, Mr. Mohan, for sparing your valuable time and coming on the show. And I think industry is very, very delighted to have your views and your very transparent and honest views on economy, on industry, on their packaging, on their sustainability, on their business models, on optimism. I think we are very much lucky to have you on this show. Thank you so much and all the best. Take care of your health.
Thank you, Sanjay. It was a pleasure meeting you. Thank you.